In this session, we'll be discussing the journal entry mapping session in the construction payroll for Sage Intacct. This is where you define how the journal ledger accounts should pre-fill for your hour types, your taxes, and your pay modifiers. You can establish a hierarchy of these rules that can be based on things like time entry project related, or just office payroll versus field payroll. One of the first things you need to do is to make sure you have all of your general ledger accounts set up in your chart of accounts over in general ledger related to payroll. This would be your taxes payable accounts, your benefit and expenses, all of that typical payroll GL expense accounts. You also need to set up a payroll accrual account we're going to use as a clearing account that will net into the amount of your total net pay for the payroll. For example, in general ledger, we're going to be using 2014, which is accrued payroll liability. This can be called payroll clearing account, whatever you'd like it to be, but we do need an account to be established and set up ahead of time to act as the offset account when we're setting up our mappings. When defining your hierarchy rules, one thing to consider is how you're going to be breaking out your cost types in the projects module. So if we go over to projects or jobs, and we go to our cost types, we need to define the cost types that you would like to post over from payroll. So for example, in the standard cost type catalog here, this setup has our laborer is going to go to a cost type called LAB. We would like our direct labor wages expense posted to LAB. This customer would also like to have the burden portion of the labor sent over, but broken out separately. So in this scenario, we've set up a cost type called LB for labor burden. Now, both labor and labor burden are going to roll up and accumulate into a total labor accumulation type. But now we can establish a cost of sales general ledger account for labor, 5001. And then we also have a labor burden expense account for all of our taxes and fringe benefits that we're going to post from payroll. And this will come into play in the next step when we're building our mappings. Well, next, if we go back to applications, construction payroll, and we're going to go into journal entry mappings, typically recommend to break out your mapping rules in different sections here to make it easier to navigate and add and edit as you're going along. And what we would typically recommend is to build your mapping rules into, you know, something like a project versus non-project coding. So you may have a hierarchy where if it's job or project related, it goes to the cost of labor expense account, the 5001. If it is non-job related or office related, it goes to a 6000 salaries account. And the same goes for your payroll taxes. You can have a hierarchy. So if it's job related, it goes and follows these rules. If it's non-job related, it goes and follows these rules, or department related as well. So you'll notice here for this example, we have our groups broken out by project versus standard or non-project related. So we have a group for all of our wages or our hour types for project related, and then for non-project related, we're just representing with the wages. And we've done the same here for taxes and benefits accordingly. So for example, if we go into project taxes, and what you're going to do here is you'll take a look and you'll see every individual tax that your company may need, and you'll need to add these, and we'll do one in a second. But for example, if I was in Oklahoma and there's state unemployment for Oklahoma, if I expand this down, what we can establish here is this is an employer tax. So we want the credit side of that tax going to 2055, which is our SUTA payable account. And we do want to turn it on and break it out by employee so we can get a nice report showing SUTA portion for each employee. And the debit side, my apologies, I went on the wrong tax ID here. Back up to SUTA. So the credit side is going to go to the 20055, which is the SUTA payable account. And on the expense side, because it's project related, we would like it to go to 5007, which is cost of sales labor burden. And when that does send that transaction over, we do want job cost detail and employee detail sent over. And on top of that, we would like it to go to a separate cost type, which we saw in the prior step, which is LB for labor burden. And you'll notice the same thing here for any of the employer-based taxes. For example, FUTA in this scenario is going to go to 2053, which is its own payable account for FUTA. This is all based on your company setup. In this scenario, we have one broken out for each tax. And so you can establish that labor burden. If I was to click back and just take a look at my regular taxes group, and this would be a mapping for employees or payroll that are not job related. So if I go back to that same Oklahoma state unemployment, I'll still have the same credit account, 25.5. It's going to be broken out by the employee, but now it's going to a non-project cost of sales account. It's going to a general expense account called benefits and payroll taxes. So this could go to your state unemployment expense or whatever you would like to send it over on the P&L side. And so we can establish this hierarchy, and you'll see in the next step where we put that all together based on these different groups. So let's go ahead and create one new mapping rule here. And we're going to go and click Create New. And we're going to give this a rule identifier, and we'll show you some examples of setting up some taxes. So let's just call this group payroll taxes. And the effective date's going to be 1/1. And I'll click Add here. And down at the bottom here, now I'll establish my different check items. So you'll need to click Add Check Item, open it up, and select the item that you would like to map out from your list. You will see all of your benefits, all of your taxes, all of your hours here. So for example, let's just do FICA. So I can best fit the tax, and I can find my FICA tax, which is right here. And I can click Add Journal Entry. When I do that now, I will typically define the credit side first. So I could best fit again in my GL account. I'll start with the twos, but I can also just scroll down. And I'm looking for my payable account on the credit side. So I have an account here, payroll FICA payable, 2051. And I want to base this off of the check date. You can base it off period end date or work date. Typically, accounting wise, it would be based off the check date. Now, the transaction amount for the FICA tax, there is both an employee versus an employer side. So we'll actually do double the entries here. We're going to set up and establish the employee side. And then we're also going to set up and establish the employer side all in one entry. So for the employee amount, for the credit entry, I just want to break it out by employee so I can have a nice report showing me the FICA tax withheld for that employee. And I'll click the plus button because now I'm going to do the other side of the entry. Now, since this is an employee deduction, there is no expense to the company for this. So this is going to come out of the employee's net pay. So this is an area where we're going to use that payroll clearing account 2014. And that is going to be the other side of our entry. And it will be the debit side. And I don't need any detail on that debit side because that's just going to be a clearing account. Basically, any of the deductions are going to be debited, and any of the earnings like wages are going to be credited, with the net amount being the employee's net payroll check. So in this scenario, that entry is good on the employee side. Now we're going to click plus, and we're going to do the employer side. And it is going to the same payable account, FICA payable, and we're going to do it check date. And it now is the employer amount. And I'm going to do the credit side first. And again, I do want to break out the employee here so I can get a nice report showing the employee deduction and then the company side of the FICA for the employer. I'll click plus. And now this is an expense. And since this is a non-project mapping, we want it to go to our operating expense area. And I'm going to search through here, and they have one where they have just one expense account. It's going, all the taxes are going here, 6020. So this will be our benefit payroll taxes. It's going to be based on check date. And it's the employer side. And now we need to do the debit side of that entry. And I'm going to turn on all the detail for the expense side so that I can have as much information as I want on the expenses reports. When I'm done with FICA, I would go on and do my next line item. So for example, if this was, let's do the state unemployment, or let's do federal unemployment. Let's do FIT. So if I want to do my federal income tax, add the journal, and there's going to be a payable account for that. FIT payable. Check date. This is only an employee side, so we're only going to need two lines here. This is an employee entry. It's credit. I want to list out the employee. Hit plus, and now this is a deduction, employee deduction. So I'm going to, again, pull in my payroll clearing account for my net pay, which is accrued payroll liability. Employee side, debit, no detail on the clearing account, and I would click save. And I would recommend saving as often as possible. You don't want to fill in 10 taxes and then you lose power or something like that. So I would click save, and then you can continue on and add more as you need to go. What's nice is when you're in this rule, as you click add and you get your list, if you're in the taxes area, you don't see the taxes that you've already set up. So the list kind of goes away as you build these mappings. And when you're done, you'll click save, and then you'll click back. And that's okay, because I already have made a save here. And then you would build your different groups as needed. So in addition, for example, I have a group here called benefits, and this is where I can put in all of my miscellaneous. If you have any reimbursements, health insurance, deductions, or employer health insurances, you know, anything like that that you have set up in the system, it's the same, you know, theory as in the taxes. You know, you can see here we have a payable for the health insurance set up, and then it's going to 6,000 health benefits because it's the employer side. So you would establish all of these up in your system in these mappings. Now that the mappings rules are established, we need to default them in the areas and tell the system how and what we want to pull in from different areas. So the next step would be to go into construction payroll and into entity configuration. And we'll be digging into more detail on the entity configuration page in another video. But in the entity configuration is where, for your company, you're going to let them know what is the default mappings you want to use. So for example, I'm in the Timberline General Construction entity that I'm setting up right now. So among other things in here, there is an area for journal entry mapping rules. So here's the groups that I established, and I would make sure that this entity uses these groups. So this would be your non-project groupings here. So basically, if it's looking here, there might not going to be a project, or they're missing a project somewhere. So basically right here is where we're going to say we're going to use this tax group, this 401k, this unions, benefits, and wages. And that's where it's going to pull from. Now, on the first hierarchy, the one that's going to take precedent over all the other ones, is the mappings that are connected per project. So in construction payroll, you have the ability to come into construction payroll into jobs, and for each jobs, establish which mappings you would like to use. So you may have a different set of rules or mappings based on the different type of project, a union project versus a non-union project, a different state. You can have as many different combinations of these as you'd like to have your general ledger pre-fill in. Typically, it's the project versus non-project. So for example, if I go into the Amazon warehouse, and let's just clear these off and we'll show you how you would do it initially. So when I first come in, I'm going to say, if this job is used, here's the rules that we want to use. Well, we want to use 401k, want to use project, all the project areas. So that's why you'd like to label it a little bit easier to follow here. So project benefits, project taxes, project unions, project wages. So it's going to use all of these mappings, not the non-project mappings, which are right here. Click Save, and you would go through and make sure all of your projects have that set up in the system. Now, some people elect to use a non-job project so that everybody's coding everything to a job number. So you'll see in this example, I do have a non-job payroll project set up. And in that mapping, you'll notice I'm not mapping to the project taxes, I'm mapping to the taxes and to the wages and to the benefits, because I want that to follow the non-job rules. So that's how that's usually determined and set up. At this point, your system's ready to test and to put some time in and check those mapping rules. And you should be good to go to post over to your general ledger. Thank you.